Good morning, and welcome to The Ready Word. I'm your host, Pastor Patrick A. Jennings, pastor of the New True Vine Baptist Church of Detroit, Michigan. For every circumstance and situation that you're facing in your life, God has a word ready for that moment. So let's proceed now into today's message from The Ready Word. Let it bless you. Good morning and praise the Lord. Welcome to another time of sharing together in the Ready Word broadcast. I trust that you know that God loves you and that you're living on the blessings of God who daily loadeth us with benefits. I want you to know today that there is nothing in your life that is insignificant to God. No matter how big or how small, whatever it is, God cares about it because God cares about you. This morning, I want to say a special hello to our Ready Word partner, Ms. Vicki from Kentucky. Thank you for reaching out to us and sharing your words of encouragement and concern with us. And I want to extend that invitation to every listener this morning. If you have the moment, if you have the time, sit down and write me at ntvbc@yahoo.com. Send me your questions, your concerns, your remarks. Just let me know you're listening, and certainly I welcome your prayer requests because I love to partner with you and touch the throne of God and trust and believe God for the miraculous. Once again today, I want to ask everyone who's listening to me to do me the favor of reaching out to at least 3 people and tell them about the Bell Global Network that's on Comcast. It's a blessing to the body of Christ. It's worldwide and people are being touched, lives are being saved, and we do have a gospel alternative in Bell Global. So please tell your friends and tell your neighbors to log in to bgntvgospel.com at any time of the day or night, any day of the week, and share in our broadcast family. Certainly you'll be glad that you did. Today I want to continue and conclude our family peace series. We opened up talking about the role of the husband in the family, and then secondly the position of the wife in the family, and then today our logical conclusion is the introduction of the children. And I want to talk about how to build kingdom kids. How to build kingdom kids. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, I do come to you and I thank you for this day. Thank you for life, health, and strength. Thank you for all the blessings that you've afforded us in this day. I thank you for another time of sharing together in your word. I release it to you now, and I surrender this moment to you, that your Holy Spirit will take charge, that your Holy Spirit will speak, that it will lead us and guide us in everything that we say. I pray, God, that you would touch every ear, touch every mind, touch every heart, that we may hear, understand, and receive to obey your word so that we can be blessed. I speak today a blessing on families. I speak a blessing on fathers, on mothers, and on children alike. I pray that your grace will be multiplied in the families of God. I pray that you would be a need-meeting God and meet the need of every family listening to me today. You're just that much God. I pray that for every problem, for every pitfall or peril that the family may be facing, that you would show up and be God in that situation where there is no harmony in the home. I speak peace right now, that the peace of God will reign supreme in every body of believers' home. I pray right now, God, that you would give us direction and give us guidance. Teach us how to live out your plan for our families so that we may receive your blessing. In Jesus' name, I pray. Creating kingdom kids or raising kingdom kids, building children with the kingdom kid mentality. I began with a very clear point of plainness that every family will have some challenges. Every family will have some pitfalls and some hurdles that we have to deal with. Some encumbrances may impede our path, but I want the body of Christ to know that a lot of the tension in the home can be resolved and dissolved when we understand and apply God's plan for the family. When we all shoulder together behind the Word of God and begin to live out what God has designed the family to be, we move from so much fighting in the family to a position of fighting for the family. God has given the perfect plan for marriage, and man cannot improve up on it. And God's plan simply states, I'm putting man in the home to be the foundational head, to be the loving leader, and the caring covering for the family. I'm putting him there to represent the priest of the home. And I'm giving him a help that is meet or comparable for his assignment, one that will partner and couple with him. I'm giving him a wife to help develop God's plan for marriage. And the leg of the family that we look at today is the marriage plan of children. And yes, that is God's plan for the marriage. He designed it, he structured it, and it's our obligation to follow it. But as God gives children into the marriage union, it blesses parents to understand the purpose of the children and the purpose of the family. If you don't understand the reason for something you have, you're bound to misuse it or unappreciate it. And so I want to begin by taking us to the book of Malachi, chapter number 2, and verse 15, where the scripture clearly says, and did not he make one? Yet had he the residue of the Spirit, and wherefore one, that he might seek a godly seed. Therefore take heed to your spirit. He says from the beginning, I took two and I made them one. I joined a husband and wife together as a team of one. They are unified in parenting partnership. I don't have two agendas. I don't have two parents. I don't have male and female. In God's mind, I only see one structure, and that is the leading, guiding structure for the home, the parental core. And he says, from this parental core, I made them one for a reason, and that is simply this, that I may seek a godly seed. It is therefore incumbent upon the parents to take on the responsibility and the charge and the challenge of delivering to God a godly family. His purpose for establishing husband and wife in the home is for the training, developing, and nurturing of a God-centered family and a godly home. God's desire is that the children of God will help implant and replicate the image of God in the world as he made man, imago Dei, in his image, to look like him and also represent him. And our children should also be raised in the same pattern, that our lives should resemble God, reflect his godliness, and also replicate his character, so that wherever we go, we're reproducing people that look like God. In the book of Jeremiah, chapter 29 and verse 6, you may remember when Israel was in Babylon and God sent a word through Jeremiah telling Israel to have children and to buy houses and to plant vineyards. If we're in an ungodly world and an ungodly land and an ungodly place, why are we bringing godly children into the world? Jeremiah was clear, because you stamp God's presence on the ungodly when you bring godly children into their midst. Our job is to recreate and replicate the image of God and stamp his image all over the world. Our children are supposed to be lights that light the way in a dark world. They're supposed to be leaders of other children. They're supposed to be those that make a difference and make a change in the world. Every time you and I as believers give birth to a child, we've just given birth to what God hopes will be a world changer. We don't birth them to get along and go along. We birth them to stand up and represent the presence of God in everything that they do and everywhere they go. When God blesses us to have children, we need to understand the purpose and the reason behind His power. And that is that His presence can be replicated. So in the home, we have a regular duty and a regular responsibility to keep God before our children, to keep the way of the Lord in front of our family. Throughout the year on the calendar, we have a lot of days that we celebrate as holidays. From January to December, we're celebrating holidays. But the actual original statement and word was holy days. And holy days over a period of time became truncated into the pronunciation of holidays. But in Israel's calendar, every holiday was a holy day. And there were days set aside in that annual calendar where the children of God turned back to God. And this holy day for Israel is to remember how God brought us out of Egypt. This holy day for Israel is to remember how He brought water in the wilderness. Another holy day of tents and booths is to remember how we were sojourners in the wilderness and God took care of us. We have holidays or holy days in the Jewish calendar to remember how God worked through Esther to deliver the entire nation of Israel. So every now and then in our homes, we need to have some holy days. And if your holidays are not holy days, you need to implement some. Have some time where you and your family stop and remember what God has done for you, what He means to you, and replicate His image in the world. Recapitulate what God has done in the journey of this family so that the father can give the testimony, the mama can bear witness, and the children will be aware that this is God's home and He's been keeping us and carrying us every day of the year. If you've ever noticed a Jewish man wearing a yarmulke, the little circular cap that he puts on the crown of his head, I see him all the time. And one time I was on the campus of Oakland University, and there was a young man in a reading room, and he was reading his book wearing his yarmulke. And I went and I sat and I talked to him. And for the first time in my life, I really wanted to get a clear understanding from someone of that faith, why you all wear that cap. And he explained it to me in a way that all these years later, I've never forgotten. He said the yarmulke is worn by the Jewish male to remind us that we're under the authority of God, that wherever we go and whatever we do, God is in charge of us. And in our Christian homes, raising Christian children, we need to make sure that even though we may not physically wear a hat, we make it clear that in this house, we're under the authority of God. Our goal of this house is to follow His mandates, His precepts, His laws, His commands, and live in a way that brings glory and honor to God. And it's the parents' job to make sure the children get that message. In the book of Genesis, chapter 28 and verse 19, while Jacob was out in the wilderness, in the desert, he had an encounter with God. He saw the ladder going up and the angels ascending and descending, and he said, "Surely this is the gate of God. I was in the presence of the Lord and I knew it not." So he named the place that was Luz, he changed it to Bethel, which means the house of God. It doesn't matter where you are, your house should symbolize the presence of God, and your house should be a house of God, meaning not the bricks and the mortar, but the people on the inside. We should live in a way that we represent God to the degree that others who see us will identify this is God's house, not the church house, not the sanctuary, not the synagogue, but your house, when God is at the core, becomes God's house. And God said, for my family of husband, wife, and children, my charge is transform your home so that your house becomes God's house. In the essence of making our house God's house, of course, the first assignment is to bring our children to the knowledge and the saving grace of Jesus Christ. That's mama's job. That's daddy's job. That really is not the pastor's job or the church Sunday school teacher job, but at home, in our quiet time, in our talking time, in our sharing time, I am to bring my children into the presence of the Lord. I am to share with them the understanding of God and the knowledge of God on some level in their own language. My job as parent is to let them know that with the mouth, man confesses what he's already believed in his heart, that Jesus died on the cross, that he was buried in the grave, and 3 days later he was resurrected. And our faith in what God has done brings our salvation and transforms us from sinners into saints. And the message should be given to every child at home first, broken down and explained at home first. The major communicators in the life of the children should be the parents as it pertains to the plan of salvation. So when they get to church, and by the time they get to Sunday school, it's really a rehearsing and a rehashing and a repeat of what I've already heard. It reinforces what my mother and father taught me at home. So when father and mom does their job at home and brings the children along in the Word of God to help them understand the plan of salvation, you lead your children to Christ at home. But let me pause now parenthetically to say that the message of salvation is not just for children. There may be someone listening to me today who is a full-grown adult and never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior. I want you to know today the plan is the exact same for you as it is for a 7-year-old child. Believe on Jesus with all of your heart, and thou shalt be saved. Make sure your children are clear on John 3:16, that God loves them. He thinks the world of them. That he took the very best heaven had and gave it in exchange for them. He won their freedom and redeemed them from the curse, the penalty, the presence, and the power of sin by allowing his son Jesus to die on the cross of Calvary. And as parents bring children into the knowledge of Jesus Christ, we now become a core of family that looks like a godly seed. And there's a responsibility on the children. And that is in the book of Exodus, chapter number 20 and verse 12. It says, honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Now, when you understand the book of Exodus as the constitution for the land of Israel, God was planting a nation and building a nation and giving direction for how this nation of Jews will look, how this nation of Israelites will live, how we will conduct ourselves. And they said, when you look at our families, you're going to see something very distinct in how our children honor their parents. It may not be the norm of the pagan culture. It may not be like other families around them. We may be seeing the adultification of children, that children now are raising the parents. He said, but in this culture, we will be unique in that our children will be raised to honor their parents. And by the way they honor their parents, those who look will be able to tell this is a godly seed. These are the people of God, and it still is true today. Honor thy father and thy mother. The word honor literally means to weigh heavier. It means to put more substance on what mom and dad are saying than anything else. My father's word carries more authority in my life than anyone else who's speaking to me. My mother's direction for my life supersedes anyone else's. That's how I honor them, by putting more emphasis and more weight and more credibility on what they say to follow their direction, their guide, and their instructions. To honor the parents also suggests a degree of reverence. And you cannot truly honor your parents without being reverential to them. And reverence is actually having a healthy fear of. In the book of Psalms 111 and verse 9, it says that the Lord's name is reverend. Literally means his character is to be reverenced. Not that that is his name. God does not have a name. But his character is to be feared. His character is to be respected. And that's how we should be in honoring our parents. We should have a healthy respect and an honorable fear. That is, some things I don't do in front of my parents. Some things I don't say in front of my parents. Certain ways I don't behave because I honor them. And if good conduct honors my parents, then bad conduct dishonors them. When I'm in trouble, when I'm chaotic, when I'm rebellious, when I'm resentful, when I'm illegal, it brings dishonor and shame on my parents. But when I live in a way that I do what I'm supposed to do, live in the way that I'm supposed to, dress the way I'm supposed to, walk the way, talk the way, act the way I'm supposed to, the way I'm instructed to, the way I've been taught to, that honors my parents. And it's one of the greatest forms of showing honor, is merely by doing what I've been instructed to do by my parents. Honor also demands obedience. So I have to get to that one. Colossians 3 and 20 says that we should obey our parents in all things. Again, he wasn't talking to all children. He was talking to Christian children. Those who say God is the head of this house. There should be something different about you and the godless house. So the godly seed is one that honors their parents by obedience, not by resistance or rebellion. Not by disobedience or disregarding what parents have said, but carrying out the instructions of the parents. Watch this. Not only in their presence, but in their absence. I remember my mom and dad used to leave home. They used to leave us with a laundry list of things to do. And we had chores that had to be completed. And they would let us know we're going to be gone for a while. And when we get back, I expect these things to be taken care of. And in obedience to your parents, whether they are there or not, you carry out their instructions. Whether you're in their presence or you're not, you still abide by what you've been taught, because that's how you obey your parents, as a result of the honor that you bestow upon them to give them a greater sense of significance in your life than anything else that you're dealing with. Children need to obey their parents. And when they are small, usually it's a lot easier. And when they reach adulthood, it's usually a lot easier. One person said that I fought and argued with my parents all the time when I was a teenager. Then I left home. And when I came back, I was amazed at how much they had learned. There is a season in life, the teenage years, that presents a special challenge for young people who are honoring their parents and obeying their parents. The late Orson Welles said, at some time, all teenagers just go crazy. And that may not be true, but there is a very difficult and different dynamic in the teenager, in that now they want to be mature, they want to be independent, they don't want to be told what to do, they don't want to follow orders or be given demands, but they're not financially able to be truly independent. So they're in a tough position, struggling back and forth between obeying and rebelling. And in those seasons, parents have to be keenly aware of how to parent in a new dynamic and a new dimension. Because now you're dealing with a spirit that's in transition and may be a little confused and may need more direction in that area. But because your children at that age may be a little sassier, maybe a little mouthier, that's no need to press the panic button. It doesn't mean they're going to hell. It means they're going through a natural process of some changes that are going on inside of them, not only physically, but psychologically and emotionally. So continue to be a parent and parent them. And Ephesians said, do it in love. Loving your children as you guide them through the courses of life. And doing that, I want to give you several things that every child needs to know from their parent. First of all, and the most important, let your children know that they are loved. Make sure you know, your children know that you love them, and you express it, and you tell them, and you actually say it. Feeding them is good, clothing them is good, putting a shelter over their head is good, and leaving to them to figure it out. I wouldn't have done all of that if I didn't love you. That's good. But it's good to hear them say it. Speak that I love my children. God said, this is my beloved son, hear ye him. Let your children know that they are liked. Liked is a statement of choice. I have to love you, but I don't have to like you. But I want you to know you're special and significant to me, and I do like you. Let them know they're valued. Let them know that they're a priority in your life, and they come before everything else. Let your children know that they're appreciated. You receive them as a gift from God, and what you pour into them is trying your best to make them the best they can be for God. And then finally, let them know they're necessary. They're a part of the big picture of God's plan for this family, of God's plan for their family, and God's plan for their families to come. I conclude by giving you 2 Corinthians 12 and 9, where God said to Paul, my grace is sufficient for thee, and my strength is made perfect in weakness. Dad, mom, as hard as we try, we all miss the mark. There is no perfect parent. We will fall short of the mark. But when we do, God makes up the difference. God bless you. Praise the Lord, saints. I'm Pastor Patrick A. Jennings, pastor of the New True Vine Baptist Church, 7125 Finkel Avenue, Detroit, Michigan, and the host of your Ready Word broadcast. If this broadcast today has been a blessing to you in any way, please reach out to me and let me know. Communicate with me. I look forward to hearing from you. You can write me at ntvbc@yahoo.com, or you can mail me at 7125 Finkel Avenue in the city of Detroit, Michigan, 48238. If this broadcast has been a help to you and a blessing to you, I'm asking you to help us keep this broadcast on the air by your generous donations. As the Lord leads you to give, please feel free to send all donations to the New True Vine Baptist Church, care of Pastor Patrick A. Jennings, 7125 Finkel Avenue in Detroit, Michigan. Until next time, be blessed. You're gonna make